of research and development centres in Portugal. So it's the equivalent to research excellence rate. It's organised in a different way. And for various reasons which were not to do with the panels, it was very controversial. But one of the things that we did during that time was that the centres who got very good or higher grade, we visited. Now that's quite alien to the UK culture, and I've often felt that it's the weakness of both the RE and the research excellence framework, that they don't actually visit. Because anybody can say anything they like when they're just writing something for you to read. But when you actually see the research centres, you get quite a different impression. And I have to say that my overriding impression of those visits was a fantastic PhD students, really energetic, really exciting postdocs, really, really good researchers. I think a lot of people, however, don't think of countries like Portugal as having things to teach us. And one of the reasons I wanted to run the papers here is because I hope that you begin to learn a little bit about Portugal and about its higher education system. And it's been on a very sharp trajectory to a modern society. For those of you who don't know any of the history of Portugal, then it was not till 1974 that it actually became a democracy. And that has meant that higher education in particular, but also school education, have had to move very, very quickly to modernise. And there's still quite a long way to go in that, particularly the north tends to be less educated than the south. And that's partly to do with distribution of employment, it's partly to do with traditional areas and so on. But that, as a higher education system, I think that what people do is amazing, because the work that people do in these systems, I think we work hard in the UK, but compared to the Portuguese academics that I've seen, I don't think we work anything like that hard. So I think take opportunities to learn about the system whilst you're here. The other reason I was quite interested is holding it in a different country, because apart from once when we held it in Dublin, then in the kind of 20 years plus of this organisation, we've never actually held an annual conference outside of the UK. So that was a first in lots of ways. Some people felt it was controversial. But given the controversy that we went through in the evaluation of Portugal, I don't think anything is ever going to be that controversial again. So I don't actually mind too much about controversy. But of course, part of the controversy was when we made the decision to come here before the Brexit vote occurred. But as soon as the Brexit vote occurred, people started saying, oh, perhaps we shouldn't be going. And I'm saying, well, we should go more than ever. Because actually, geographically, we are still going to be part of Europe. Socially and culturally, we're still going to be part of Europe. So this kind of notion that somehow, you know, when it, whatever comes out of the Brexit negotiations, goodness knows what that will be, but we're not suddenly going to be cut off in the sense that they're going to separate us geographically. And I think it's really, really important that everything we do in terms of postgraduate education thinks about the European context. And I also wanted, which used to happen at the beginning of the history of the UKCGE, to come back and have the annual conference in a university. And this is a university that I've got to know. I've got to know some of the people who work here, particularly in this faculty, but not exclusively in this faculty. And I think it's quite important that we don't lose the link with academic institutions, because after all, that is our membership, and that's what we're about. So that's kind of why we're here. But I hope also that you will enjoy the city. This Porto is a very beautiful and very photogenic city. And yes, I'm sorry it's raining, but it is by the sea, and sometimes it doesn't. So I couldn't arrange the weather, I tried to arrange everything else. Okay, so the first session then, let's move to that. So we have two speakers. The first of them is Maria Jo Ramos, who is the Vice Rector for Research and Development at the University of Porto. And I first met Maria when I was doing a piece of interviewing research after I finished the evaluation, because I wrote a paper comparing the Portuguese evaluation and the research excellence framework. And I asked somebody I knew in the senior team here, Peter Teixeira, who's in charge of academic education and so on, if I could interview the Vice Rector of Research. At that time I didn't know who it was. And so I turned up at Maria's office on a sunny day in June 2015, and I'd been told that she was a chemist. And I was quite nervous, and I was thinking, no, she's a chemist, she probably won't like social science very much. And actually, we got on very, very well. So that was quite a fortuitous meeting. But I mean, Maria's a kind of very, very distinguished scientist, and she's done all kinds of interesting things. I mean, she did her first degree at Porto, but then she went to Glasgow, and then she was a researcher in various other places. And And she became a professor in 1991, and she's done some amazing things since then. I won't read all of them out because they're in the pack. But the fact that in 2014 she was actually given an honorary degree by the University of Stockholm, I think gives you some sense of the kind of way in which she's regarded in her academic context. But today she's here to talk about her experience of running an international training network with research students. What we're going to do with this session is both speakers will speak for about 10 minutes and then we'll open it up to discussion. So our other speaker is Rebecca Boden, who's currently director of the new social research programme at the University of Tampere in Finland, but until very recently was professor of critical management at Roehampton University in the UK, and before that worked in various other universities, including Cardiff Metropolitan and also the University of West England. And her background is, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, she's not a tax inspector, but anyway, you may or may not want to know that, you may not be a teacher. Financially informed analysis of what's going on in education in general and what happens to the money that is actually poured into higher education and also school systems. And that I think is quite an important lens for us to have. And by no means all accountants necessarily do that kind of research, but it seems to me that it's quite important. I mean, Rebecca's here because she was involved with another international research training network called UNIQUE, which is actually on higher education, and Porto was one of the institutions involved in that. And so she's going to talk a little bit about that. And later on today, one of our other plenary speakers, Marisa Nera, she was actually the evaluator for that project. So we got some interesting links across different sections. Anyway, so I'll hand over now to Maria and Rebecca, who will talk a little bit about the networks they've been involved in, and then we'll open up. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Rosemary. We're making this up as we go along to some extent, which I suppose is probably the lesson of the training networks that both Maria and I have been involved with. So we're carrying on as we always have. I'm going to talk a bit first, but Maria's going to interrupt me where appropriate, and vice versa. We're doing it that way because we come from quite, as you just heard, different perspectives. In the, it's quite interesting really to compare how these kind of networks differ between the very much hard sciences and the social sciences. Quite interesting perspectives on that. But talking to Maria, it's quite interesting with the similarities that we've got as well. Doing a PhD, especially in the UK, which is where all my experience of supervision is often a very kind of lonely experience for all social science students and also for supervisors as well. It tends to be a single student working usually with two supervisors. We can be all quite socially isolated from the student, but also quite intellectually isolated. So we don't in social sciences tend to have students working in large projects. So they're also, we have a problem that quite often the student's area of interest or some topic that they're pursuing isn't in the direct or immediate area of interest of the supervisor. Obviously, they've got to know what the student's doing. But the idea is the student's craft is something quite individual. So all this creates kind of problems and issues sometimes for students. It's also my experience that in the UK we tend often not to be, or we can not be very nice to PhD students in that we call them students and we tend to treat them as students. And in a lot of countries, for instance Denmark and indeed Finland, PhD students are in fact treated as kind of junior members of the faculty. They're researchers along with all the other staff. And the only thing that distinguishes them is that they're still working towards their doctorate. And that's something that I've always urged should happen in the UK, and I've been seemingly unsuccessful wherever I've worked in getting that to happen, because I think we really should be treating PhD candidates as as our colleagues rather than our students in that way. Unique was, you know, interrupt when you feel you want to. Okay. When we started our training network in 2013, it was called an initial training network. They're now called innovative training networks because everything has to be either innovative or excellent these days. It's called UNIKE, which stood for Universities in the Knowledge Economy, UNIKE. You can look up the web page at unique.au for Office University, .dk, they're not. As 4.3 million euros, we had 12 PhD fellows, as we call them, or students, three postdoctoral fellows across five countries with six partners. The partners were Roehampton, where I was, Bristol University, Lyon in France, Aarhus in Denmark, Porto, you know where Porto is, and Ljubljana in Slovenia. And that was really kind of interesting and challenging in its own way. And it was great in many ways to kind of mix up those countries. It had its advantages and its disadvantages. In addition to the official partners and the fellows and so on, we were actually quite successful in attracting a little travelling bandwagon of young people mostly who kind of stuck up, well, actually also people in those media. So people who became sort of informally associated with the programme. In a very nice way. I think one of the PhD students who started turning up to our events and so on, who we treated as affiliates of our IT and also benefited immediately as well. So the whole gang was quite good, quite important. We were able to have that kind of loose structure. As I said, it ran for 4 years to January 2017, so it just finished. And what it really did, apart from the 12 PhDs and the postdocs who worked on the project, they worked on their own research, but they also contributed real work to the programme in terms of arranging publications, mentoring and advising the PhD students and so on. The fellows. The fellows got, see how easy it is to slip into them. The fellows, in addition to their kind of supervision, also got quite a heavy training element, which for these EU programmes is a large part of what you have to promise to do. So I think Marese will correct me. I think they ended up with eight kind of formal events, one of which was here in Porto, of course. And I think one of the best things that the fellows got out of it was being part of that cohort effect. So they had a big group of people who were working in analogous areas to them, who were kind of, they could benchmark themselves against, they could collaborate with, they could talk to, they could give mutual support to, and so on. And that, again, had pluses and minuses. But quite an interesting experience trying to pull these people together. It was also a unique experience for me as well, because I never before been part of a programme of PhD candidates. So it's very, very interesting for me. It did a lot for me thinking about how you run things and also about the PhD experience. So there was a lot of reflection in there for me as a PhD supervisor, and Marese was particularly helpful in that she sort of was a big part of what we did was have Marese kind of test and challenge us about what we were doing and why we were doing it, and what we as supervisors could learn out of this whole process and how that would impact on our supervisory practice elsewhere with other students. I think it was a great experience for the PhD fellows, actually. I don't know if you know much about these ITNs, but these people get, quite frankly, enormous salaries. The ones who've gone on to jobs in the UK, and a couple of them have, I suspect would take quite a significant pay cut as a result of moving off of Munich into a regular lecturing job. They are extraordinarily well paid, they're extraordinarily well resourced for the students, the fellows. So not only is training included as part of what they get, they also have very generous allowances for research expenses, for going to conferences, going for doing their field work, considerably in excess, I might say, of what professors in UK universities get. Well, very well resourced at that level. And they also had access to a fantastic international group of professors who were part of the whole programme. So I think it was a great deal. Really was a good deal for those fellows and the postdocs who were involved in the programme. In that sense, it's very, very generously resourced. When I come to think about how well it worked, the biggest problems we came across actually was that here was the EU specifying a particular sort of programme, the way we worked, so things like mobility, having a large number of international partners was deemed, you know, absolutely crucial to this. And yet we all worked within our individual universities. And you might begin to imagine the difficulty as a professor trying to be involved in coordinating with, you know, five other partners in four other countries in my case. And try to get your own university to accept its responsibilities to the EU, who were demanding that we work in one way, requiring that we work in one way, and then six individual universities who thought that they would carry on as they were, thank you very much. And that caused enormous difficulties, and it consumed inordinate amounts of academics' time, quite unproductively, to my mind. And that's largely because universities' structures are not set up to work in this way. In my new job, which is running a 5 million euro research programme that's interdisciplinary in Tampere, I'm getting the same kind of issues but within a university, because I now have a group of 11 professors I'm responsible for at Tampere, and they're spread across four different faculties. And the faculties in Finland are all very independent of each other, so it's like dealing with four different universities. So I'm getting a replay of those kind of problems. So I'm battle-hardened now. And I think universities, this isn't a problem unique to the UK, are not well suited to collaborating with each other in these programmes, and that's quite problematic, I think. We have problems around things like recruitment, for instance. So we had to recruit these fellows onto these very lovely, very well-paid jobs. Each university had its own recruitment protocols, and yet we wanted to appoint them as part of the programme. So just the sort of ideas of the kinds of problems that we had. Mobility was an enormous issue that caused enormous problems for us, because there's a requirement for the ITN that the people you appoint have not been resident in the country where they're going to work for more than 1 year prior to being appointed. And so that involved people moving not just around Europe within the EU, but some of our fellows came from outside the EU, so from Ethiopia or St. Lucia in the Caribbean, for instance. And that just created inordinately complex issues around visas, permissions to stay, etc., which were quite frankly ridiculous as well. We even had some mobility problems within Europe, ironically. So we had one young lady who was from Germany, who moved to Slovenia and had the most horrendous difficulties, even though they're both EU countries. So that again was quite an eye-opener, and I think the students, the fellows, whilst benefiting greatly from the mobility, because it really did break up that habit of always kind of staying in one country and only being located there. It's fantastic to make them go to another country and experience working in a different environment. Practical problems associated with that work were ridiculous, and universities are not geared up to that, but countries are. You know, now I'm an accountant and a former tax inspector, the financing of this project was equally horrendous because we were trying to run this 4.3 million euro budget across six universities, all of whom are desperate and short of cash, all of whom have their own rules, all of whom buy and compete, and all of whom screw up and then want more money out of the project. And the fighting and squabbling over that was horrendous. So, Roehampton, for instance, HR made this terrible mistake when they appointed the fellows, which Bristol didn't make, which is that the money comes into the university in euros and they were paying them in pounds. And Bristol very sensibly set up contracts with the students that they were paid the euro exchange rate equivalent, which meant for the people at Bristol their salaries fluctuated in accordance with the EU exchange rate. And Roehampton didn't do that. It just agreed to pay them in pounds, and of course the euro was gaining strongly over the pound, and the euro is coming in, we're buying fewer and fewer pounds, but we still have to give the same amount of money to the students. And that's just indicative of really kind of basic errors on financing that can occur. So, anyway, that's my rant over on that. That sort of thing really shouldn't happen. Finally, there's the sort of coordination between the partners issue, which was also quite problematic between six universities in five different countries. And we had kind of meetings and we tried to coordinate things, but the multiplicity of PhD regulations, multiplicity of administrative forms between universities, and multiplicity of personalities across, you know, six lots of academics in five different countries, made those coordination issues incredibly difficult. I feel that the fellows we got were fantastic, actually, mostly young people. They were across a variety of disciplines, so we had not only six universities in five countries, but also had a very interdisciplinary group, which I think is different from Maria's and chemists. So we had people from many different disciplines. One of the things I think that I was just talking with Maraisi about this, we agreed. One of the things that we as a group of supervisors and partners absolutely failed to do was really develop a kind of coordinated approach to the supervision of the fellows. We really didn't kind of sit down as a group and think and reflect on our supervisory practice. We did it on our own, we did it one-to-one with other people, but in many ways we didn't develop a kind of consistent supervisory approach for the fellows. And I think that, and we probably had an overly complicated structure for them in that the fellows had their supervisory teams within their host universities, but then they also gave them mentors, which were other partners. And also there was a lot of family training events, people came together in many ways, and we found that a lot of students, a lot of fellows started opinion shopping. So if they didn't like what you were telling them about their thesis or suggesting they do, they would go off and ask somebody else. And then come back and say, oh no, X says so. And this became really difficult for them. And you know, you'd be having conversations with the fellows at conferences, and I said, you might try so. And then they take that as advice and then they go back to their supervisor and they say, oh, Rebecca says I've got to do so-and-so. And in a sense, I think on reflection, we didn't do enough work helping them situate how they got advice, where they got advice, how it was to be mediated and how we were to to work together, and I think we could have done more on that. What else? Going? Rosemary's nagging me to finish now. So, if I suppose if I sum up really, I could say the students work very well together. These fellows, they did form a very, very close group. Those who finished their theses so far have, almost without exception, gone to very good jobs. These are fellows very much in demand. And I think that's come because it's not because they're in some way better than other PhD students who are graduating. I think it's just they tick a lot of correct boxes in terms of their experience and the prestige that comes from the programme. I'm not sure that the partners worked terribly well together, and if I was doing this again, I think we'd possibly kind of work in different kind of ways, and that wasn't helped by the organisational issues. I think the mobility for the fellows was a fantastic opportunity, and it would have really enhanced them and enhanced their careers. But we found that the multi-site working across six universities was just, at times, incredibly chaotic and very, very hard. And I think there's a view in the European Commission about how these things work and that's what they look like on the ground. In sum, though, I'd say, you know, for the fellows involved, there were absolutely fantastic opportunities. I'm really confident we produced sort of like, you know, 12 really, really great kind of fellows, and it was great for them, but I think there needs to be more reflection, honest reflection, because you have to report back to the EU, say how wonderful it all was and didn't do anything wrong, but it would be quite good if there was more honest reflection around what people did right and what people did wrong, and some kind of pooled resource to help people in the future do that. Sorry.
Well, first of all, I'd welcome you all to the University of Porto. Thank Rosemary as well for the invitation to come here and share my experiences on this ITN with all of you. My, so to speak, ITN is still running, so I still have one more year to go. And our experiences on the whole, very much like Rebecca's, that's why I didn't interrupt you. And, also with the differences, the way it all started is also different. So my IPN is called Theoretical Chemistry and Computational Modeling, which is what we do. We do chemistry with computers using quantum mechanics. So that's it. I'll stop here. And you don't.
No, sorry.
Anyway, so we call it TCCN. Okay, let's just change it because it's easier. So this TCCN generated from another TCCN, which was a master numbers. And we were eight then. We started this a long time ago, about 8 years ago. And we liked each other so much, we were eight universities, that we decided to go on to an IPN. Now this TCCN was so successful worldwide, because people thought it was very good, that other universities made pressure on us to come in to the IPN. So from eight we went to 12, and we had to draw a line because more and more wanted to come, and it was becoming a problem. So I've been there from the very beginning, and I'll just tell you, the universities are very good. I'll just tell you who they are. So it's the Autonomous University of Madrid, Spain, University of Barcelona, University of the Basque Country, the University of Groningen in Holland, Catholic University of Berlin in Belgium, the University of Pierre-Marie-Curie Paris 6 in France, University of Perugia, in Italy, University of Pisa in Italy also, University of Porto, which is the only Portuguese one, University of Corsa Latte Toulouse 3, in France, University of Valencia, and University of Vienna in Austria, or in Switzerland. And so this is the 14 of us. There are quite a lot of Spanish universities because those were the ones that made more pressure and so we just get out of it. Later on, the University of Stockholm came in as well, but as a partner, not as a beneficiary. So all these 12 universities are called beneficiaries. And then we also have partners because we thought we were so clever and we would give our students the best possible thing. And so we devised this program, which everybody thought was absolutely amazing. And it looks very good on the paper, not so sure it's so successful when you actually run it. But I'll tell you why. So then we've got, as I was saying, 14 partners besides this. And these partners are mostly companies, and such as Glaxo, for example, Glaxo Smith Klein Research, the chemist, remember that. And also, the University of Stockholm became one of the partners because, you know, the pressure was such, we couldn't get any more beneficiaries because the whole thing was getting out of hand. And so, you know, because of our, and we had 12 more of this. So what we thought was, okay, we'll have a supervisor, we will have, all the students will have a program which will be the same, okay? Not the project that they were running, but the way it would go, it would be the same. So all the students have got three supervisors in three different universities, and they've got to go to all these universities, and they've also got to go to two of these partners. Okay, so imagine the mess. Anyway, we thought this was clever because it would give the students not only the opportunity of seeing how different universities work, different groups, different companies as well, would give them packs of contacts, and all this worked out very, very well. And they do, they get all that and more. But together with them going to conferences and all this sort of thing, and the students are always on the run, basically. Because, you know, I wonder how they have time to think. We didn't think about this. And now we're seeing it's too much. But everybody thought it was a good idea. Which, as I say, on paper is a good idea. They're definitely getting all this. But they're not getting the time to think that they should have. So if I were to do it again, I obviously did not have so much ability. On the good part of it is that we had so much more experience with the master, the supervisors, I mean, plus all those that were just desperate to come in, that the supervisor lot all work out beautifully. We all get on fantastically. Finance was no problem whatsoever. I nearly interrupted you there. We don't even know how much we get. We just work for the love of it all. And so that was no problem at all. We all have a lot of fun when we get together. So all that is great. So where does it go wrong? I mean, obviously, things go wrong. Some things are good, some things are bad. So I'm talking about finance. We forgot that with all this ability, the students come from all sorts of countries. And it's a nightmare. So I've got Ukrainians, Nigerians, you know, coming to me and say, Professor, I can't get a visa, you know. I'm supposed to go to, I don't know where, one of these, Poland, you know, and I can't get in because I also can't get out of Portugal. I haven't got an exit visa and I don't have an entry visa. And I can't stay in Portugal anymore because my visa is running out. And so you think, what am I supposed to do? So it's a bit of a nightmare with all this. Yes, so if you ever do something like that, please remember that people come from different countries and then the visas are just problematic. So that is difficult. So the mobility plum has to come down with this mobility thing. Then we have Cotutels. Cotutels was definitely a form of torture. Because, I mean, it's a mental torture to anybody that is, has got a bit of sanity. Because it is just completely crazy. It's all very well that we all have the same values in Europe, more or less. I mean, culture is different, but I mean, with it. We all get on together famously, we didn't hike in. But the university is working different ways. And they all think that they have the best way of approaching these products. So if one university says, this jury, I don't know if you know what co-tutels are, but in within this, you probably do, you must have. And so if this university, you know, says the jury has got to be, of the PhD, has got to be formed in this particular way, that's by definition the best. It doesn't mean that the supervisor thinks that, I don't think that about my Portuguese bureaucracy thing, or my Spanish colleague, but the bureaucrats of those universities do. And so if I say, okay, so the jury, the defense of the PhD is going to take place in Spain, the Portuguese say, no, the system is different, and ours is better. Or ours is, it should be, because it's the law, yeah. So that's it. So, and how do you cope with it? So the core supervisors are left to have to contend with all this. So we have been doing that, but it's a bit of an idea. So the bureaucracy becomes a bit horrendous to say, it's really actually that's document signed. So, anyway, to the PhD students themselves, they are, I hate to say, the ones that we have anyway, very convinced of themselves. It's an idea in which everybody's the best, which contends a little bit. The only people that are tolerant are the supervisors, we're friends, you know, and put a lot of experience on these things, but everybody else is the best. So the students are the best. And Brussels is the best. The idea is the best. Because, believe it or not, these are competitive things, as you know, and this idea, which is a complete madness in mobility, if you go and tell anybody from Brussels that I said that, I'll deny it. the students just think that anything they say, even the weakness, they are a fortune. They are more than some of the young professors here, yeah. Or in Spain.
And the UK. Yeah.
And probably the UK, I don't know what you mean. Certainly here in Spain. So in a fortune. They have the pilot pen, anything else, they come and say, there's money from Brussels to buy that. So you have to give me a pen, or whatever it is, the most ridiculous thing, you know. And anyway, they're very nice, but they should calm down. I told you just now, a lot of people should calm down in these things. And, but these are not the bad things. The good things are that the network has been incredibly successful as far as collaboration. The PhD students are very well considered. We have intensive courses for them as well, so they are well taught. They don't have much time to think, but they are well taught. And so they aren't out here for the ITN. I can only think about the master students that have been requested from all over the world. So they say that they attended this master and TCC UKCGE asked them of us, and they have open doors, and they perform well, as I know. So as I said, the PhDs can come out of it, so I can't really say much about that. And it's been altogether an enjoyable experience, if I have to, with a lot of, months and thinking, oh my God, how am I going to solve this, and all this sort of thing, and I thought, somebody, this is a nightmare. I will never do it again. And I applied for another one. I think it's like having children. Never again. Then you go home and have another one. I mean, you have a plan. So anyway, this is more or less what I can tell you from my own experience.
Very similar in many respects, and I think that's my time. So, we're going to questions. We've got about 10 minutes for questions. So, anybody's got any questions or comments or experiences? Can you say who you are?
I think in Sam, I'm from the University of Portsmouth in the UK. Just some comments, actually. I'm slightly concerned about Maria's comments on mobility. We all know, obviously, mobility does offer a lot of benefit. I don't need to educate people here. But obviously, there are practical difficulties, especially ones you mentioned in terms of international students, the visa issues. But I'm just really concerned with words like madman and tremendous and bad things.
You have to remember I'm a Latin.
Because those issues obviously are challenging, and I think it does highlight the need for better planning and better management and a better understanding of what's involved with international students in terms of the mobility offer. I think personally there are huge benefits, and instead of saying, well, putting a slight negative stigma is we should probably focus on our better planning, enhancing student experience, and resolve those issues, aware of those issues, and resolve those early on, so we have a better experience. But that is my opinion.
Yeah, I like those words, but if you'll have to excuse me, that's my personality. I mean, as I said, I'm a Latin. I feel my feelings, I have my feelings very deep. Yeah, the bureaucracy was horrendous and all that. I imagine that in the UK, for example, the bureaucracy that I have against here in Portugal, the bureaucracy in the UK will be better. Because usually here I must say it was not pleasant. From the point of view that I spent, in my opinion, too much time on it. So I should be doing research, in my understanding. I should be supervising my students, doing good research, collaborating with my colleagues, producing excellent science. That's my point of view. So I spent maybe a quarter of this time that I had put aside to dedicate to all this in the IPN. I spent it doing, running after, whoever they have to sign that document, phoning the visa place, saying, please, what are you doing? Get this, I've got this student, what am I supposed to do with him? And things like that. Yeah, so, and the one time of that, to me, is that.
Yeah, I don't think you should take on those admin side of it. It does highlight that obviously the admin support and the support system is not sufficient.
But actually, that lack of support, I think, was evident across all of our partners in our ITN as well. And it is inevitably the academics who end up doing that. But I also was thinking, there is to be saying something else about mobility, which we also found, in that our fellows spent a lot of time travelling around the world. and they spent a lot of time going to training events. So we had, I think, 8 events, each of which really took a week out of their time. There was a lot of preparatory work for those and so on. And my feeling and their feeling is that that took an enormous amount of time away from the PhD itself. And at times it almost felt like the thesis was a kind of ancillary to the ongoing training. And I think that we got that out of kilter. They were incredibly busy all the time, and it was all good stuff, but I would have liked to spend more time on their thesis. I don't know if you have to say.
No, as far as I'm concerned, their PhD, to do all this, all this covering, all this mobility, all this interacting with other groups, because if you go to another group, you have to understand, obviously you understand, but you've got to, I mean, we don't all do the same stuff. We are in theoretical person and traditional modeling, but, you know, we all do different things. So go to another group. You have to, you follow your project. This was also difficult to get projects that would run smoothly across the whole groups. But this was done beforehand. And you have to interact with the group. You meet different people. You meet people that are doing different science. And this is difficult for them, for students themselves. It takes time. So to do all the mobility and get all the benefits that we thought they'd get, in my opinion, they will need 5 years, not 3.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's my
take one more question.
Sandra Barnes, Bristol, in the UK. You've talked about the obvious advantage to these fellows for being part of this program and the PhDs that are underway or emerging. Are there any benefits for the supervisors who've been involved? Academic kinds of benefits, I'm thinking of.
Yes, I mean, you know, I had the opportunity to work with a really great bunch of people across those countries. A lot of them I knew already, so because you can't put one of these networks together really unless you've got an existing, a bit like your experience. So I don't think there were, for the most part, people I didn't know of and kind of, you know, share ideas and stuff with already. There was a lot of advantage in terms of it was good for me personally in terms of thinking about supervisory experience and so on. Unique has a application going through for a sort of subsequent ITN. I couldn't be part of that at that point because of Brexit. So that. But I think, you know, it does build ongoing partnerships and so on, don't we?
My answer is short. Yes, very good. Very, very, very positive.
Right, well, thank you very much. I mean, I hope that for those of you who know about these networks, and of course you've experienced some of these things yourselves, but my guess is that not everybody has had that experience. But I think it's important to talk about it because as we see the balance between the thesis, the thinking about what you're doing, and the moving around the world actually conflicts with each other some of the time. So yes, mobility is good, but it also has some downsides. But clearly there are pluses and minuses with the students.